go home. Oh. It's not even going home. It's going to the principal's office, and it's getting done.
Yeah.
It's bye-bye. Because I was like, his family's not checking, or he's just really sneaky about it.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Welcome to Gloria Dei. In case we haven't met, my name is Jonna. I'm one of the pastors here. And if you need it, we have childcare available across the way for ages 0 to 5. And we also have some fun stuff for the kids during the worship service. So I'll leave it up to you. But you are welcome to stay and have your kids in the worship service. We are thankful for your presence. We also want to let you know that in case you need it, we've got support for your littlest ones. Let's stand and greet one another this Easter Sunday. Reading from Acts chapter 10. God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and water, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the love of Christ I live. There in the crown his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand. Thank you.
may be seated. Well, there's a lot of new faces today, and because of that, I'll explain this before we do it, but we have this little tradition here at Gloria Dei where I say, "Glory to God, Gloria Dei," and you all respond by saying, "Glory to God." So we're going to try that right now. Glory to God, Gloria Dei.
Glory to God.
Amen. What a beautiful day it is. This Easter Sunday, we are so lucky to be here together worshiping in the presence of the Holy Spirit. If you are new with us, my name is Alec. I'm one of the pastors here. My better half was already up here, but I'm up here now too. But we are just so happy to have you here worshiping with us today. If you are new with us, we have these little blue hospitality cards. If you want to fill one of these out so we can get to know you just a little bit better. And if you have a prayer request, you can flip it over and write that on the back, and we would love to pray for you. So please take a moment to do that, and you can just give these to one of your ushers either during the offering or at the end of the service. After the service today, we have some really, really fantastic stuff going on. You may have seen there's donuts and coffee and fruit and some treats out there. After the service, we're having a potluck, so there's going to be food out there. And we also have a photo booth. It's completely free of charge. If you are dressed up and look nice this morning and want to get the family Easter pictures taken, we have got you covered, okay? So please, take that opportunity. Take as many pictures as you want. It's totally fine. They're going to be here for the whole time after the service, so please join us for that. We actually have one really, really important announcement this morning as well, and that is on May 19th. Now, I know, May 19th, that's a little ways down the road, but this is a big announcement. We're going to be announcing it a lot from between now and then. We are going to be changing our service time. So we have been meeting at 9:30, but we are going to be moving to 10 o'clock. And if you're curious about why we're going to be making that move, you know, we have talked to some of our younger families that have kids, and one of the consistent things we've heard is, it is really hard to get our kids up and out of bed and get to church at 9:30. We are here, but as we continue to seek to engage young families in our community, this is something that we've heard from young families is something that's important to them. So we are going to be moving to 10 o'clock from 9:30 to 10 o'clock on May 19th. And along with that, on May 19th, we are going to be having a big barbecue and fellowship celebration right after the service at 11 o'clock. We are going to have bounce houses for the kiddos. We're going to have the barbecue going and lots of fun games and stuff going on. So it is going to be a blast. We are really excited for that. So we will continue to announce this, but make a note of that. 10 a.m. starting May 19th. In just a moment, I'm going to invite our ushers forward to take our offering this morning, but it does give me the opportunity just to mention that if you are new with us, if you've been here, you've probably heard me say this a bunch, but here at Gloria Dei, 10% of everything that comes in, we give and give to our mission partners, and that is mission partners both locally here on our campus, our food pantry that does amazing work. Mary, our food pantry director, is doing so much great work over there, and our early learning center, and our partners locally with Love Inc. and City Team, and then our partners abroad with Tartu Ministries in Estonia and Lutheran World Relief that does amazing work all over the world. So 10% of everything we give goes directly to that. There are lots of ways to give. If you see up on your screen, you can give online. We're going to pass the offering plates. We have got little envelopes if you'd like to put an offering in there. And you can also just scan the QR code if that's easier for you too. So we are going to worship in song as we take our offering, and I'd like to invite the ushers forward now.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne. of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the
with me as we pray. Holy God, as we come before you on this Easter morning, and we look around at our world and our community, it can be so easy to lose hope. When we see brokenness, when we see division, when we see a world that is torn apart by conflict, when we see unhoused people right outside of our fence, Lord, we see these things and we yearn, we crave, we call for your justice. But Lord, this morning is the great reminder that no matter how bleak things may look on Friday or Saturday, Sunday is coming. Sunday is coming. Lord, in this act on Easter Sunday, you let your hope pour out upon this world. And Lord, for the entirety of human history, death had been the final chapter. It had been the final note. It had been the end of the story. And then you came into our world and you said, no more. Because the tomb was not meant to be filled. It was meant to be opened so that you could walk out. And your kingdom would pour forth, as the prophets say, like rivers of living water. Your justice will flow down. So God of mercy, we no longer look for Jesus among the dead, for he is alive and has become the Lord of life. Increase in our minds and hearts the risen life we share with Christ, and help us to grow as your people toward the fullness of eternal life with you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
I'd like to invite the children to come forward for a children's message. You're welcome to come and bring your little ones on forward. And George, you up for coming forward? Yeah? All right. This is one of my favorite things. So come on forward. Bring your kids on up. We've got something fun. Hopefully for the kids, but definitely for the adults. So come on up. Wow, Destin, you look so handsome this morning. Hi, honey. Hi. Are you walking yet? Oh. And good morning. What's your name? Bailey?
Miley.
Nice to meet you, Miley. Well, come on forward if you want. Have a seat. Find a good spot for your skirt. I know that's kind of tough. So I brought something that might be kind of fun for you all. We got lots of Bibles for our kids when they, even before they were born, people knew that they'd need lots of Bibles. So I thought that I would read you a little story. Do you like stories? So this one's called Easter. Jesus journeyed from town to town to spread God's message all around. He was put to death upon a cross, but hope for us all was not lost. He lay for 3 days in a tomb, but then he rose up from the gloom. When he died, he saved us from sin, and now we praise and worship him. So as little kids, you remind us of life. That's one of the best things, I think, about kids. You remind us that life continues. There is always new life. And in Jesus, there is new life and life forever. Man, you've got a great smile, just like Destin. And I got something kind of fun. So at Easter, we celebrate that Jesus was in the tomb, but then he was out of it. So today, I have some fun hats for you to wear. Oh my goodness. Is that okay? So this is not an advertisement, I promise. Do you like wearing hats? Oh, and do you think Mommy would like one too? Here's a couple more. So we are celebrating that Jesus was not dead forever. He was alive. He was in and out of the tomb. Unlike when you go to In-N-Out, you're there and you stay there forever to get through that line. Okay, let's pray. Can maybe your parents help me pray after me? All right. Dear God, we thank you for Jesus. That death was not the end. That Jesus was in and out of the tomb. And we thank you that that means life for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for coming up, Miley. Thank you, Destin. Thanks for coming up. Happy Easter. Yeah. You can go back to your seats. Thank you.
Today, our scripture reading comes from Matthew 28, verses 1 through 10. If you've got a Bible, you can open it up and the words will be up on the screen. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning. His clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In case any of you are wanting one of those hats, I've got more. They were happy to give me some advertising materials. So thank you all for being here. Despite the Cheerios and the craziness, the demands on your schedule, preparing those Easter baskets, working on that ham that ended up being burnt, all of the things, you made it. You are here. And we don't take your presence among us lightly. My dad used to joke, only half tongue-in-cheek, that the hour before worship was the hour of the wailing and gnashing of teeth. So you made it. We are glad to have you in and among us here today. And we also have Easter baskets available for the children after the worship service. So make sure that you get one of those on your way out. Today we celebrate the most incredible, amazing, jaw-dropping, unbelievable day that has ever happened in world history. Today we celebrate the first person to be raised from the dead, never to die again. Today we celebrate that because of Jesus' death and resurrection, death does not have the final word. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Today we celebrate that because Jesus lives, we too shall live. Today we celebrate a day that seems almost unbelievable to modern hearers. And of course it does. It was unbelievable to those who were there 2,000 years ago. I'd like to tell you a story that seems simply incomprehensible. Two women, both named Mary, had followed Jesus and supported his ministry, and they'd been there all the way to the cross. They had seen his shameful and agonizing death. They had heard his cries from the cross. They had remained there as he died. These women had not wanted to miss a moment, even though those moments were the worst in their lives. They had been there and mourned for the one they had loved, the one who had healed them and given them meaning and purpose in a culture which couldn't care less. They had been there when all others had fled. They had loved Jesus to the very end. And then Jesus died, crying out in a loud voice. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. Unbelievably, the bodies of many dead people who had been holy were raised to life, later appearing to many people. A centurion and those who were with him guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened. They were terrified, and they exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." And as evening approached, Jesus' body was wrapped in a clean linen cloth, and he was placed in a new tomb. A big stone was rolled in front of the entrance, and Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting opposite the tomb. But the two Marys had to leave to observe the Sabbath, a religious observance. And what a terrible day that must have been. They could no longer be with Jesus. They couldn't even be with his body. The one they had loved had died, and there was nothing more to be done. So they went home and waited. They waited until Sunday, when they could return to that tomb. And at dawn, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary go to look at the tomb. There is a violent earthquake, and an angel of the Lord comes down from heaven, rolls back the stone, and sits on it. His appearance is like lightning, and his clothes are as white as snow. The guards are so afraid of him that they fall down like dead men. Can you imagine this scene? An earthquake, an angel that looks like lightning, a gigantic stone rolled away, and guards fainting right and left? Then to top it all off, the angel speaks to the women. "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him." So what do the women do? They are terrified out of their minds, yet they're filled with incredible joy, so they book it. They run to tell Jesus' disciples that he is alive and will meet them in Galilee. It doesn't matter that they are women, and that no one will believe them because they're not considered reliable witnesses. It doesn't matter that the men who denied him and ran away in Jesus' hour of need get this message. It doesn't matter that this is the most unbelievable story anyone has ever heard. It doesn't matter because somehow, miraculously, Jesus is alive. And as they are on their way, suddenly, out of nowhere, Jesus meets them, and he gives them a big, long speech. "Hi." Don't you love it? It's so good, so understated. "Hi, it's me, Jesus, back from the dead. No big deal. Glad you're here." And the women fall at his feet and worship him, and he repeats the angel's words. "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to meet me in Galilee. There they will see me." Jesus calls the ones who left him his brothers, not just disciples, brothers. It doesn't matter that they all ran away. Jesus has forgiven them, and he wants them to know. He needs them to know that they are forgiven. He wants them to see for themselves. He wants them to know that they've got an important job to do, to tell the world about Jesus so that all might follow him. They've got a big job to do. So incredible. Jesus, back from the dead, alive, and he is present to it all. He is present to the fear, the joy, the denial, the abandonment. It's all a part of the journey, and Jesus accepts it, and he's present to it. The fear, the joy, denial, and abandonment are all a part of our journey too. And Jesus is present to us in all of it. Jesus is undeterred by our very human responses and doubts and shows up in the most surprising ways and unexpected times. And sometimes it feels like all he says is, "Hi." It's incredible. It's so incredible to tell someone the story of Jesus' death and resurrection. It can feel embarrassing to say it out loud and then to say that you believe it. Frankly, telling our 3-year-old son wasn't easy. It felt like I was telling some old fairy tale to a little boy for the first time, that a man who was also God, named Jesus, died and was raised from the dead so that all who believe in him will live again too. As I was telling him this story, this truth that I believe, I wished that I had an easier truth to tell him. And I think that that's how the women felt that day too. Imagine telling someone that you witnessed this truly out of this world experience. Imagine the anticipation of disbelief because you're not a man. You're not a believable person. Your story is not as valued. It makes a person tongue-tied. You know that it's incredible and frankly unbelievable. You know that the other person believes something else and for their own good reasons. You know that sharing this incredible story can make you look like a fool. And this is precisely what faith in Jesus is all about. It's foolishness. Yet to those who believe, it is the power of God. As Lutheran pastor and theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, "Christ did not come into the world that we might understand him, but that we might cling to him, that we might simply let ourselves be swept away by the immense event of the resurrection." I'll say that again. Christ did not come into the world that we might understand him, but that we might cling to him, that we might simply let ourselves be swept away by the immense event of the resurrection. The resurrection of Jesus is so big, so incredible, that we could talk about it all day long. We could talk about the theology, how, in fact, it's actually logical, but we'd only be scratching the surface. Because the deeper truth is that what we are truly desperate for is not a logical or theological treatise. We are desperate for a person who will change our lives, a person who captivates our imagination, a person who makes life worth living and death less fearful. It was author and theologian C.S. Lewis who wrote, "Sometimes fairy stories may say best what's to be said." And perhaps he was right. In his timeless classic, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, Lewis wrote about a Jesus character, a lion named Aslan. Aslan humbly allowed himself to be brutally killed so that a snot-nosed traitor named Edmund might be saved. But it required Aslan's shameful death. All his tormentors left, and the girls, Edmund's sisters, mourned for this lion that they had loved. In the wood behind them, a bird gave a chuckling sound. It had been still for hours and hours that it startled them. Then another bird answered it. Soon there were birds singing all over the place. It was quite definitely early morning now, not late night. The country all looked dark gray, but beyond, at the very end of the world, the sea showed pale. The sky turned bright red. They walked to and fro more times than they could count between the dead Aslan and the eastern ridge, trying to keep warm. And oh, how tired their legs felt. Then at last, the red turned to gold along the sea where the sky and sea met, and very slowly up came the edge of the sun. At that moment, they heard from behind them a noise, a loud noise, a great cracking, deafening noise, as if a giant had broken a great giant's plate. The rising of the sun had made everything look so different. All colors and shadows were changed, that for a moment, they didn't see the important thing. Then they did. The stone table that Aslan had laid on was broken into two pieces with a great crack that ran down it from end to end. And there was no Aslan. "Oh, it's too bad," sobbed Lucy. "They might have left the body alone." "Who's done it?" cried Susan. "What does it mean? Is it more magic?" "Yes," said a great voice from behind their backs. "It is more magic." They looked around. There, shining in the sunrise, larger than they had seen him before, shaking his mane, stood Aslan himself. "Oh, Aslan," cried both the children, staring up at him, almost as much frightened as they were glad. "Aren't you dead then, dear Aslan?" said Lucy. "Not now," said Aslan. "You're not a, asked Susan in a shaky voice. She couldn't bring herself to say the word ghost. Aslan stooped his golden head and shook his forehead. The warmth of his breath was a rich sort of smell that seemed to hang about his hair and came all over her. "Do I look like a ghost?" he asked. "Oh, you're real, oh Aslan," cried Lucy, and both girls flung themselves upon him and covered him with kisses. "But what does it all mean?" asked Susan, when they were somewhat calmer. "It means," said Aslan, "that though the witch knew the deep magic, there is a magic much deeper still. Her knowledge goes only back to the dawn of time. But if she could have looked a little further back into the stillness and darkness before time dawned, she would have read there a different incantation. She would have known that a willing victim who had committed no treachery was killed in a traitor's stead, the table would crack and death itself would start working backward. Death itself has started working backward. Death has been conquered because Jesus died and rose again. And he died for you. No matter how unbelievable or fairy tale-ish it may sound, it's true, and it's for you. Jesus is for you, and Jesus changes everything. I wonder what will happen next. Let's pray. Holy God, we thank you that in your great love for us, you did not stand far off, but you came down. You sent down your only Son, Jesus, to live and die for us because you love us. You didn't die because we were good or we were perfect or we could understand it all. But you died and rose again so that we might be forgiven and so that we might have life, so that death would not have the final word, that death might begin to work backward. God, we pray that you would continue to expand our imaginations so that we might know you better. Because we are honest and saying, this is a story that seems pretty unbelievable. And yet, this is your story for us. This is your truth. And so, God, we pray that you would continue to expand our minds so that not only would we believe it deep in our bones, but that it would change our lives. God, I pray that you would be with all of us, expand our minds, our ministries, our families, and we thank you for your goodness to us. And we pray these things in the name of your only Son, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Now I invite you to stand and declare that because he lives, we too shall live. Let's sing together.
I believe in the sun.
future in His hands. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because He lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends.
Hear these words from the Message from Matthew 28, verses 16 through 20. Meanwhile, the 11 disciples were on their way to Galilee, headed for the mountain Jesus had set for their reunion. The moment they saw him, they worshiped him. Some, though, held back, not sure about worship, about risking themselves totally. Jesus, undeterred, went right ahead and gave his charge. God authorized and commanded me to commission you. Go out and train everyone you meet, far and near, in this way of life, marking them by baptism in the threefold name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Then instruct them in the practice of all I've commanded you. I'll be with you as you do this, day after day after day, right up until the end of the age. Now, it's interesting because I think that sometimes on Easter Sunday, it's the culmination of all of these things that have happened, right? We've walked through this Lenten season, and we've come through Holy Week and Good Friday, and then we reach Easter Sunday, and we have this triumphant, joyous moment in the resurrection. But here's the thing. Easter Sunday isn't the end. It's the beginning. This is the beginning of the story. And as we read these words of the good of the Great Commission, I think it's important to remember this, that this is the beginning of the story. Today is important. Tomorrow, Monday, the work begins. And so you may be coming to us today and worshiping with us today from all kinds of different places. You may have been at this church for decades. And if you have, we've got lots of work to do, and you know that. Maybe this is the first time or the second time you've ever been to this church at all. And we just want to say thank you, and we're happy you're here, and encourage you to take a next step. Maybe you've never been in a church ever. And as Jonna said, this sounds a little weird. This story, is this real? Sounds a little unbelievable. But it's okay. It's okay. We would love to walk with you. Schedule a meeting. Give us a call. Send us an email. We'd love to grab lunch with you just to chat about it, Jonna and I. Maybe you had been in the church for a long time, and you haven't been back in a long time because the church has hurt you. Maybe that's how you're coming here today. And if that's the way you're here today, if that's where you are, I just want you to know we love you and we see you and we're happy you're here. And we hope that this can be a different experience than some of the ones you've had before. This is the beginning of the story. As God tells us, and Jesus says to his disciples, I will be with you day after day after day until the end of the age. We live now in the already, the work that Jesus and God have done, but the not yet, because it's not fully complete yet. It's in process. We're all in process. And that means the work still has to be done. So now I'd like you all to stand as we worship God through song, singing, "Thine is the Glory."
Again, thank you so much for joining us for Easter worship. We hope that you'll hang out for a little bit for our potluck, and if nothing else, get some really good donuts and coffee and an Easter basket for the kids before you head out. We hope, Alec and I hope to be able to get your name and to get to know you a little bit better. Thank you for coming. And now receive this benediction. The God of all, who raised Jesus from the dead, bless you by the power of the Holy Spirit to live in the new creation. Amen. So, alleluia, go and tell the news that Christ is risen.